can start.
Sir, thank you, sir. A very good evening to one and all. We welcome you all for day three faculty development program on emerging trends and challenges in electrical engineering. Respected patron Dr. C.H. Srinivas Garu and convener Dr. M. Ramesh Garu, professor in HOD EEE department. Today's resource speaker, Dr. Fanindra Babu Garu, professor Garu, and all coordinators and all the participants, a very warm good evening to one and all. Today's topic on applications to wireless charging system in electric vehicles. And today's eminent speaker is Dr. Fanindra Babu Garu, professor in Department of EEE at GRIIT Hyderabad. I'm honored in reading out the introduction of our today's resource person. Sir has completed his PhD from IIT Delhi in the field of electric vehicles in the year 2014. And sir has completed his post-graduation from JNTU Hyderabad in the field of power electronics in the year May 2005. And sir's graduation has been completed from SRKR Engineering College, Andhra University, from the degree of Bachelor of Electrical and Electronics Engineering in the Department of Electrical and Electronics Engineering in the year 2000. Now presently, sir is working as professor in the Department of EEE at the GRIIT Hyderabad, India. Sir has published more than 35 number of publications in both national and international journals. Sir has total 20 years of experience, in which 15 years comes under teaching and 5 years of research. Sir is also working as lead technical consultant to InstaSign Technologies. Sir is also working on consultancy projects of rupees nearly 1 crore 40 lakhs client projects. And sir has been a reviewer for IEEE conferences, APEC conferences, and many etc. Sir is also a reviewer of journals IET Industrial Applications, IEEE Transportation Electrification Journals, IEEE Transactions on Vehicular Technology, etc. Sir has organized international conference in the year 2019 in GRIIT and IEEE when sir was working under 2015 in Shivnagar University. Sir's area of interests are electric vehicles, hybrid electric vehicles and plug-in hybrid electric vehicles, hybrid energy storage systems, and many more. Sir, I welcome you for this session, sir. I thank for accepting our request for our invitation, sir. I would like to request you to continue the session, sir. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for nice introduction. So shall I proceed with my presentation?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, right. Thank you. I would like to thank, first of all, the management of Vageswara Engineering College and also the EEE HOD Ramesh Garu for inviting me for this talk. In between, I will be sharing two videos related to this wireless charging technology. Yeah, thank you. Today, my talk is related to applications of wireless charging systems in electric vehicles. As he rightly specified, I am working right now in GRIIT as a professor in EEE department, and also I'm working for a few companies as a consultant for especially in the EVs area. And right from my PhD, and then after the PhD, I'm working in this area actually. So going ahead, so this is
yes sir, exactly, no problem sir.
No problem, right, thank you. So outline of my presentation is a history of wireless power transfer, and then after that I'll give a light introduction about the wireless power transfer, and then main features, and then you have different modes of operation of this wireless charging system, and then how to improve the efficiency of this wireless power transfer system using compensation technologies. And then next is different standards which is available in industry right now. What are the standards you have to follow? And then I'll be presenting few works what I've done in this, especially in the wireless area, wireless area related to EVs. And then I'll touch upon what is the importance of charging infrastructure in India. And then I'll give few conclusions after that. So the term the wireless power transfer is not at all new for the scientific community actually. If you see this figure, Nikola Tesla has performed these experiments in the year of 1856 performing the experiments in this era. So in the 19th century itself, he has performed some of the experiments related to this wireless power transfer systems actually. It's not at all new. But why, I'll touch upon the points in the coming slides, why this technology is now is very important for the scientific community, why the people are looking for this wireless charging systems actually, that I'll touch upon in the coming slides. But what I'm going to tell you is here, it's not at all a new concept. It is already there. It is well proven concept in the 19th century itself, but with some limitations. If you see this diagram where Nikola Tesla is demonstrating this wireless charging system actually, and he is able to transmit the power 48 kilometers apart, two objects which are 48 kilometers apart, and also he is able to transmit the power transmit the power to glow in 200 bulbs actually. And a main thing he has not considered is in these experiments he has not considered human and other safety issues. He has not considered even efficiency is not at all considered in these cases actually. And later on, if you see this, this is one of the very important coil structure where this is called the Tesla coil. Mostly all the scientific community, whenever you want to work on the wireless charging system, people will be looking at this wireless Tesla coil actually. So the main thing is he is able to transmit the power between two objects in 48 kilometers range. But he actually has planned for the between the continents, that has not happened actually. I'm not going into this Tesla coil. A lot of improvements are there. Here he has used a spark gap and all. These are the very inefficient things. Nowadays we have the very advanced systems are available. So we are not. I'm not talking about this Tesla coil right now. But Tesla coil is a very good thing to start as a researcher. And then if you see this introduction slide where you can see the multiple objects, like left hand side diagram represents different ways of powering your systems, moving systems and stationary systems. You can see the first diagram. Diagram A indicates the roadway powered electric vehicles, and then diagram B indicates in the left hand side some of the examples I am indicating here. You can charge the aeroplanes through wired, okay, you can see the smartphone how you are going to charge, under the robots also you can charge using this. In the later slides I will show you what are the other applications of this wireless WPT systems. And if you see this right hand side diagram where if you see this diagram, in this power transfer will be done in two ways, like when the object is stationary, another one is object is mobile. You can do it in the two ways. In the both the ways you can do it. Okay, so as an electrical engineer especially, we are talking about right now in this talk we are talking about this inductive and then conductive. Inductive wireless power transfer system, we are not at all talking about capacitive and even conductive also. Conductive is nothing but wired charging systems. We are not talking about that. And then after that, how can you do it even in the moving conditions? We are talking about this also. And then if you see, these are the different applications where this wireless power transfer system is very important right now. You can see this left hand side diagram where biomedical implants, lot of research is going on. So many implants are available in current days. So and all these, apart from these few other components also there, why I'm indicated these things are, I'm working on these components. So that's the reason why I have indicated here, but some other components are there. Wireless charging based biomedical implants are there. Very interesting other application is UAVs, that means drones. Drones placing nowadays a major role in especially in the pandemic situations, and also in suppose in war conditions, the drones play a major role. So the scientific community is very much interested on how can you extend the range of drones. Okay, that is one of the interesting idea where you can apply this wireless charging technology into this drones, actually, like surveillance drones, and then deforesting. You can identify the deforesting conditions using drones. So many things are available. So right now scientific community is also working on how can you charge the drones actually wirelessly. It's not because the range of your drone depends upon the size of your battery, right? And if the size of the battery is very small, then the range is also very small. So you need to come back and charge. So why can't you do it wirelessly without coming back to the destination? That is one of the very important idea. People are working on that. Then next, coming to the electric ships, people are also working on the electric ships. Some of the components, very critical components, why don't you charge using wireless charging technology? Another one is a very important concept in power systems, especially when the vehicle is charging, vehicle to grid concept. Okay, so vehicle to grid means you will be charging through wire. Okay, so remove the wire now. That is a concept here. Why don't you remove the wire? Okay, and then charge your vehicle, and then whenever you require from the vehicle, you can give back power to the grid. That's a concept. That is also people are working in this area. So these are the potential areas where you can go into, you can go, you can, this WPT system go into actually. So now I'm going into the the main features of your wireless power transfer system. Now if you see a little bit of battery side also, I'll give the introduction, because you see the here, you can see these are the vehicles right now very popularly available in the market, especially this Nissan Leaf, Toyota, all these things are electric vehicles. But I not listed here our Indian vehicles, where one of the Mahindra E20, and then some of the vehicles are there. Mahindra and Tata also developed the EVs that are not listed here. And these are all vehicles. And then you can see the battery capacity. Why it is required is you should know about the battery capacity, because if you know the battery capacity, based on that, you need to design your charging system actually. So this is the range of battery capacities. And the battery size will depends upon again your distance. That means how much distance you want to travel in a single charge, that depends upon your battery size. And right hand side diagram indicates the different battery chemistries. Okay, that is not the point of discussion in this talk actually, but since it is a charging system, you need to discuss about this. You need to touch upon these areas also, like you have lead acid, nickel metal hydride, GBRA, and lithium iron phosphate, and even you have the sodium chloride batteries, lithium sulfur batteries. So many batteries are available right now. The basic idea is, in all these things right now, lead acid is ruled away. No one is using these lead acid batteries. especially in the developing countries. In India, people are using still lead acid batteries. But right now in the market, and also on all the developed countries using this lithium iron phosphate as the one of the alternative, that means which is having very good specific energy, okay, and even specific power, okay. So this is the one of the one of the main component of your vehicle. Now coming to the main features of WPT system, okay. So you need to, first of all, whenever anybody asks you to design wireless power transfer system, you need to think about what is the level of the power you want to transmit, right? The first point you need to understand. And then, see, now these are the classifications actually. Up to 1 kilowatt, you can call it like a low power. And 1 to 100 kilowatt, we can call it like medium power. And high power is more than 100 kilowatt, okay? So these are the ranges, okay? Based on the range, you need to design the other components actually. And how much distance you want to transmit the power. Suppose I want to transmit for how much distance, like 1 meter or 0.5 meter or 100 centimeter or 20 centimeter. What is that gap between the two coils? I'll show you what is the two coils and all, okay? So what is the gap between your two main components, okay? So at this point of time, just I want to show you a small video where in that video it is explained what is wireless charging system, what are the different components, and I'll go further, okay? Just I'll stop the share here and then I'll go to that video.
Daniel Scribe. What do these old devices have in common? Wires. With the exception of major appliances, the evolution of electronics is wireless technology. We even receive the internet wirelessly, and we're starting to charge our phones wirelessly. And as vehicles become electric powered, it's safe to assume that wireless charging is the inevitable path. Imagine a future where electric vehicles charge wherever it parks, while stopped at a traffic light, or even as it drives along the highway. This would finally put an end to range anxiety, and is possible by electromagnetic induction. Electromagnetic induction involves two electromagnetic coils, which are simply wires, usually made out of copper, that are wrapped around a core and have electric currents running through them. One coil is a transmitter, which in the future will be on a charging pad in a parking space, at a stoplight intersection, or even embedded in the road itself. And the second coil is below the vehicle, serving as a receiver. And as electricity passes through the transmitter coil, it generates a magnetic field and transfers energy to the receiver coil, charging the vehicle. So industry experts believe that wireless charging for electric vehicles will be implemented in four phases. The first phase is simple residential systems. Second, wireless systems will emerge in parking lots. Third, on-street parking spaces. And then fourth is farther out into the future, when we will see dynamic wireless charging systems embedded into highways. And the first phase is already unfolding, as there are at least two companies that have already developed residential-grade wireless charging systems, including Evitran and Witricity. Evitran is based out of Virginia and has wireless charging systems available for the Tesla Model 3, the BMW i3, and the Nissan Leaf, with various output levels between 3.3 to 7.2 kilowatts, which is around the typical home power rating range. Witricity is based out of Massachusetts, and their system stands out because their output range is up to 11 kilowatts. On top of that, auto manufacturers themselves are developing their own wireless charging systems, including Nissan and BMW. While phase one of wireless charging appears to be well on its way towards implementation, but phase two through four will need government support. And this brings us to the UK. Back in July, the country proposed a plan to dedicate £40 million towards research for wireless charging technology. This includes investigating wireless charging solutions for streets where off-street parking is not available. And they also want to research wireless charging solutions for commercial vehicles, such as ride-sharing service vehicles and delivery vehicles. So I'm excited to see what comes from this research, and if it's even half as compelling as the US Department of Energy's research, it's going to be amazing. The Department of Energy-sponsored Oak Ridge National Laboratory has recently demonstrated a wireless charging system with an output of 120 kilowatts, which is equivalent to a Tesla supercharger. And the lab isn't stopping there, as their long-term goal is to develop a wireless charging system with an output of 350 kilowatts. This would allow electric vehicles to charge in 15 minutes or less. In order for dynamic wireless charging systems to be economically viable, meeting the 350 kilowatt goal is critical. You see, as the power output improves, the number of coils needed to be embedded in roads is reduced, along with the cost to install. So hopefully Oak Ridge can continue to make progress and make it possible for wireless charging to happen while we're driving down the highway. In the meantime, we can already see a dynamic wireless charging system in action with a demonstration project done by Qualcomm Technologies. Qualcomm constructed a 100-meter test track in France embedded with a 20-kilowatt wireless charging system. While 20-kilowatt output is not nearly powerful enough to be economical, it's still awesome to see, and it shows that dynamic wireless charging will someday be a reality as the technology improves. And it shows that with wireless charging technology, it's only a matter of time until we see the end of range anxiety.
Yes. So if you see this video, you have two components mainly. One is the you have a vehicle base, and then vehicle base you have one component, and then below the ground, that means you need to embed your coil into the ground. So there is a distance between these two. What is that value? Okay, how much value, how much is the distance between your the coil which is embedded into the ground is known as the transmitter, and then the coil which is there beneath your car base is known as your receiver actually. So the what is the gap between these two? That is very important actually. So if the gap is high, then the power transfer efficiency also very low actually. So the gap between, that means the how much distance you will be transmitting the power plays a major role. Okay, and then there is, you can see the another point here. The first point is whenever anybody asks you to design and also what are the features of your wireless power transfer system, if anyone asks you, it's a medium power range and how much distance you'll be transmitting, okay, the gap between the transmitter and receiver, and then is there any intermittent object? Suppose between a transmitter and receiver, nothing is there. There is a air. Between medium is the air here in the electric vehicle especially. Other applications, it will be different. Suppose if you are powering your pacemaker, which is there in the heart, near to the heart, okay? That is a pacemaker is for the pumping the blood, okay? So there the medium is different, okay? Like the medium, what is the medium? That also plays a major role. Okay, in between, is there any obstacles while transferring the power? Because if there is any obstacle, what will happen is power transfer capability will decrease. So, and next thing is the number of transmitters. That means transmitter means how many coils coils are required. Okay, suppose I want to transmit some 100 kilowatt of power or something like 150 kilowatt of power, you need instead of doing with one coil, you can connect in series multiple coils actually. So how many transmitters are received, okay, how many transmitters you need to design, and similarly number of receivers. Suppose you want to transmit the power to the receivers, multiple receivers, not a single receiver. Okay, that I'll show you in the later slides what are the applications of this, and whether your system is viable for whether stationary system or mobile system, and then what is the medium actually. These are the factors which you need to specify as the features of your WPT system. Next question is, next one is now, so what are the factors which are affecting your wireless power transfer system? See, now previously you have seen what are the features. how much it is, how much gap between your transmitter and receiver, what is the medium, and then what is the power range, all these things. These are the features of your WPT system. Then, what are the factors that will be affecting your WPT system? That means wireless power transmission system. So suppose you want efficiency of 95% or something like that, and the distance, if distance is far away, then efficiency will fall down. And then what are the geometry? See, now I'm starting from this point, efficiency point, and the distance between your transmitter and receiver, what is the load, and then what are the composition topologies, and at what frequency you are operating your WPT system, and alignment, and coil position, volume and weight, and geometry. These are the factors which are affecting your WPT system performance. Suppose now I want to concentrate on efficiency, then what type of geometry you have to consider? That will depends upon the application actually. See, now in EVs, I want to have the efficiency of something like 95% and above from DC to DC. This is called the DC to DC efficiency, okay? So not the between the coil to coil efficiency. Then if you think in that direction, then what type of coil geometry you need to select, or and whether it is perfectly aligned or not, okay? And suppose I want to improve the efficiency, but I want to operate at something like 20 kilohertz, okay? It's not possible. In 20 kilohertz, getting 95% efficiency is very difficult actually. So you need to go for the higher frequencies, okay? Something like that. And then what type of compensation topology you need to select to get that efficiency, okay? So generally, very critical factor is the efficiency, okay? Efficiency in any application, consider in any application, maybe EVs, or it may be biomedical applications, or it may be UAVs, drones, whatever application you select, okay? The efficiency plays a major role in the designing of all other system components, okay? So you need to consider all these factors, okay, while designing your WPT system. And then I would like to show you here exactly in vehicles how these two, that means wireless and wired, both are there, right? So wired and wireless system, these two are entirely two different systems. But if you see actually in the electric vehicles especially, okay, some commonalities are there. If you observe this is our conductive charging system. With wire you are charging. And this, the bottom one diagram indicates the wireless charging system. And if you observe here, up to this, you can see here, is there any change? Nothing changes there, right? And before this, you can see here, the power electronic. This is the power electronic, and this is the power electronic system. But there is a coil here, and there is a coil here, okay? And then the coil is connected to the grid. And similarly here, what is happening? You will be connecting to the grid through this power electronic circuit, right? So only the thing is you need to have the extra two coils. Apart from that, mostly all other things are, all other circuits are having similar power electronic circuits. So not much difficulty in replacing your conductive charging system with inductive charging, provided you will be having very good road transportation system. In the sense, see, the very critical part in the wireless, why this is very difficult to adopt, especially countries like in India, is this transmitter, you need to embed in the road, okay? That means you need to have a contract between whoever is laying the road, right, in state and central. So you need to have a proper communication between them and then your OEMs, okay? Then only you can simply bury these coils into the road. Okay, otherwise it's very difficult. But that is not there in the case of our wired charging system. But only that the advantage is here. So there is no direct contact, right? Simply you can come, the vehicle come here and the lie down here and it can charge. If it is perfectly aligned, it will charge. But here what you have to do is you need to connect with a cable, okay? And sometimes this will be very difficult actually, especially in the parking lots and all. Creating this environment is very difficult, okay? So especially this type of technology, this wireless power transfer technology, is very much useful for the autonomous driving conditions. Like now the mostly all the Western countries are moving towards the autonomous. Okay, especially highways and all these places for driver safety and all, people are going for the autonomous conditions. Okay, so in that case, this wireless charging is very useful, and also indoor environment. Suppose you want to travel in a big factory in which is having some kilometers distance, then this wireless charging is a very viable solution. Okay, so then coming to the next slide. So these are the different types of wireless charging systems available in the right now going on. So, but we are discussing about this middle one actually. A middle one and this static wireless charging, dynamic wireless charging system in this discussion. We are not going for the far field power transfer system. We are discussing about short field wireless power transfer systems. Now, this is the representation of static wireless charging of EVs, and you can see here whatever you have seen in the video, it is similar actually. You can observe here there is a there is a charge controller. That means from the grid you will be getting the power, and then to the transmitter, and then receiver will be there at the bottom of your car, and then receive. See, now very important point is here. What is the this is input is AC, and then AC to what you have to do here? Directly, can you give directly AC to this transmitter? Transmitter is nothing but a coil, right? So how the power is transferring between this receiver and transmitter? Based on electromagnetic induction, right? So this is transmitting between power is transmitter transmitted between transmitter and receiver using electromagnetic induction. Okay, so the distance between these two is as per the J2954 standards. The distance between these two is 20 to 30 centimeters maximum. Okay, so that means vehicle base to the ground is 20 to 30 centimeters. Okay, so beyond that, if you are operating, then it is not as per the standards. So now you can see here, from the grid you will be getting AC, and using converter. Okay, very important point is for transmitting the power between this much distance. Okay, this much distance means for 20-30 centimeters itself is a huge, because generally in the transformers you don't have any distance, you don't have any air gap. If you have a small 0.5 mm air gap in the system, you need to have huge ampere turns. But if you see here, in this case you have a medium is air, and then you are maintaining 20-30 centimeters distance. That means what will happen is here, it's very difficult now. So that is the reason why you should not operate the system at 50 Hz or even at the 20 kHz. You need to go for the higher frequencies to get the efficiency more. Okay, that's the reason why, especially in the electric vehicles, as per the standards, electricity and other electron standards, you need to operate your inverter output. The fundamental must be at 85 kHz, 85 to 89 kHz. Okay, that means the transmitter, which is a coil, is getting an AC wave with a fundamental frequency of 85 to 89 kHz. And receiver also will have the same frequency. So that's the reason why you have a rectifier here that converts to the DC. Okay. And then here you will be having a control mechanism to charge your battery. Okay. This is about the static system. Okay. And as per the literature, you can see this diagram which indicates what is the efficiency till now reported. Okay. Not only in the publications, and also in the you have seen the video, different companies have already demonstrated the static wireless charging systems. Even dynamic also, they have demonstrated. But efficiency are a little lower. But you can see here, even you can see from DC to DC, the efficiency is 90%. It is already reported actually. And then overall efficiency is 85%. That means from the AC source to the battery, okay? So the reported efficiency is 85%. Now it is still increased to 90%. Okay. So because this has happened because of only one thing, because of your power electronics. So without power electronics, this is very difficult to work out on the wireless charging. That's what in the first slide I told you why the Tesla is failed to transmit the power. Okay. And also very low over efficiencies. At that time, the power electronics is not matured, but nowadays the power electronics are very matured our electronics and control very mature. So you can transmit the power with higher efficiencies. And also because of this GAN and SIC devices, you'll be having very good efficiencies. And very important point is, you can see here two coils are. This is the secondary side. This is the primary coil. Primary coil is nothing but transmitter, which is there in the road. And secondary coil is nothing but which is there in the vehicle base. Okay. So, and here the efficiencies we have achieved nearly 95. But from DC to DC efficiencies, DC to DC means after this, you get a DC. And using high frequency inverter, as I said here, left hand side diagram, you need to convert this into AC, and that will be transmitted here through coil, okay, and then the secondary side using rectifier will be converting into DC. Okay, so the reported efficiencies are indicated here. Okay, and next thing is, these are the companies already demonstrated this. It is not at all especially in India, some companies are also working. People are thinking that wireless is not a viable solution, but that is not the correct one. So many companies and universities already demonstrated this technology, especially in the Western cities, Western countries. Okay, these are the companies working on these static wireless charging systems. Okay, even you can see here, but right now these are operating at different frequencies. Operating frequency you can observe here, 90 kilohertz, 20, 100, because they have developed long back. But now already there are some standards as per J2954. One of the very good standard for the wireless charging system is J2954. Okay, you can refer that. So all these nowadays you cannot work with 20 kilohertz. Okay, wireless power transfer system with 20 kilohertz, you will get very poor efficiency. You can observe this here. Okay, and then if you go for 85 to 90, you get a 95% efficiency. That is already reported, okay, but at the lab prototype level. Now the companies also demonstrated at the on the roadside actually. So this is about the some of the companies which have developed this static wireless charging systems. Now coming to the next one, this is a very important application where you can see the dynamic wireless charging. That means when the vehicle is moving, you have to charge, okay, so at what speed. Okay, the vehicle is moving, you have to charge. Means the vehicle is running with something like 100 kilometers per hour, you won't get the efficiency. Okay, so there is some limitations about this. Okay, still the companies and the Western countries are working on this. You can see here two ways of developing this dynamic WPT is there. Okay, this is the coil which is present in the ground. Okay, this is the transmitter one and transmitter two. So whenever the vehicle is moving, then you need to switch on these coils. You can observe this K1, K2, K3. So now when the vehicle is entered into the track, then what will happen is you need to develop this communication mechanism. I will show you in the later slides what you have done in this. This is called the track control. In the sense, you should not switch on continuously wherever the vehicle is there. Suppose the vehicle is near to the coil one, you need to switch on this coil, and the vehicle is leaving the coil one, you need to switch on the coil two. It's like that. Okay, you need to have the track control, otherwise you lose the lot of power and the efficiency will be very poor. Okay, so I'll be showing some demonstration, some models what we have developed in our lab previously. So those things you can understand, how can you do that. Okay, next thing is, these are the two ways we can transmit the power wirelessly. Okay, one is, you can keep a long track, okay, like something like 500 meters. Okay, long track, you continuously power this, and the vehicle is moving on this, then continuously it will charge, the battery will charge. Okay, and next way of doing it is, you connect the multiple transmitters, and then whenever the vehicle is moving on this track, whenever the receiver coil is aligned with the transmitter one, then this coil one, transmitter one will be excited, and when the vehicle is leaving the transmitter one, transmitter two will be excited. Like this, it will be going on. Okay, this is another way of doing. These two things are available right now. People are working on these two technologies, and these are the companies and also some universities developed this
wireless charging systems, okay? So, but at low power levels. Low power levels, even in that case also, they have got this around 90% efficiency. But these are in the lab prototype level. But now people are working on the highways and other areas. Now, these are the two things. Just now what I said, this is static, okay? You need a inlet power. From there, you need to place this inside your road or in the basement, and then you need to transmit the power. And then this is the converter, and then it will be charging your energy storage system. This is the parking area. Where your parking area is there, you'll be placing this charging socket, okay? That means there won't be any direct contact, okay? So this everything will be inside the ground, okay? And this is inside the wall, and this one will be in the ground. Okay, you will not see the charger. Whenever this enter into the parking lot, and then it will be charging. That means the driver will get the authentication. If you authenticate saying that you can charge, then automatically charging will start. Okay, that much convenient will be there. That's the reason why this wireless charging is very much applicable in the case of autonomous driving conditions. And you can see this is another way. This is about the dynamic charging system. This is our static charging system. You can see here, this complete track is there, okay? When the vehicle is moving on this complete track, on this, continuously power will be transferred to this battery, okay? Now here, if you see, you can see the small boxes. These are the power sockets to these coils. So whenever this is aligned with this, the coil, the system will be charged. And then whenever it is leaving, then other coil will be aligned to the receiver and it will be charging. Okay, charge control. This is called the charging track control. Okay, so what are the standards available for this? Especially I said J2954 standard, you can refer, where it will be clearly mentioned what are the charging levels and also what are the frequencies you have to use while using this wireless power transfer system. Okay, so now, so these are the other standard levels, other standards. You can refer these standards. Okay, they are both compared here, both wired and wireless charging systems standards. Okay, you have to look after J2954. This is one of the recent developments in our WPT systems. These are the different standards available. Now, these are the three different types of WPT techniques. By using these techniques, you can transmit the power to the vehicle. Actually, the first one indicates the inductive power transfer system, where you can observe here, this is the DC link. Okay, before this, you have a source, and then the from the source, you will be converting into DC, and from the DC to AC, you need to convert here, and that AC will be at what frequency? That is very, very important here. Okay, as I told you already in the previous slides, you can see here, this is the inverter, high frequency inverter, plays a major role in the transmitter side, especially to plays a major role while transmitting the power. The design of this is very much important actually. Okay, so this inverter has to be operated at what frequency? That is very important. Okay, especially in the drives and other areas, you will be operating your drive, especially the fundamental, will be at 50 Hz. That's not the case with your wireless power transfer system. Very important point is you need to consider at high frequencies, because the gap is more. Gap between your transmitter and receiver is more, 20-30 centimeters. It's a huge in the case of transmitting the power. Okay, so you need to go for the high frequency. And next is, even if you go for the high frequency in the IPT systems, especially inductive power transfer system, it is reported that 50% efficiency you will get. Okay, so this is the capacitive transfer is also there, but I am not concentrating on this. I am talking about these two. Okay, IPT system, and the bottom one is called the magnetic resonance coupling based transmitting system. Okay, so IPT system you combine with compensation topology. Compensation means you will be compensating your leakage inductances, other See, whenever if you don't have this compensation topology, what will happen? There's a lot of leakage will be there, okay, right? And that will create leakage inductance, okay? So how can you compensate that? And also, there's a lot of leakage means what? Leakage in the power means what? You need to, that means you need to require a lot of reactive power requirement, okay? So these two you need to address actually. Suppose you need to reduce the reactive power requirement and also you need to reduce your leakage inductance. That you can achieve with your MRCT. That means by operating this with magnetic resonance. In the sense, by adding a compensation topology in the transmitter side and receiver side, you can do that. Okay. And what is the type of compensation topology you need to select? That depends upon the application. Suppose you want a constant current, then you need to go for the CC topology. Or if you are series to series topology. Okay, if you want to go for the constant voltage, then S and P will be used, series and parallel topology. It's like that. That depends upon your application you need to select. So next step is now in this, how can you improve the efficiency of your WPT system? First thing you need to consider is, in inductive power transfer system, the efficiency reported is less than 50%. It's very low, actually. So now, to improve your efficiency, you have to go for the MRCT. Okay, so this is the comparison which is given, the differences between inductive and magnetic resonance technique. Okay, both are near field only, but the power range in this case is low and medium, but you can transmit high power here. High power you can transmit. Okay, so even frequency is medium, nowadays it is going for high also, and the efficiency is high in this case. Flux linkage is less, flux leakage is less. It is a very safe technique. And then, little bit complex. You need to tune your system actually, regularly, because the load is continuously changing. Suppose when the vehicle is stayed on the transmitter, above the transmitter, and the load is constant, then that's fine. If the vehicle is slightly moving, it is not perfectly aligned, then it is very complex to create a tuning mechanism. Okay, so that is called the load reflection on the source side. Okay, load reflection on the source side plays a major role while designing your wireless power transfer system. But by using this MRCT, you can do that. The next thing is, you can see here, these are the points I just told. You can compensate your leakage inductance and reactive power. And if you are able to compensate your reactive power, you can able to reduce your VA rating of your system actually. That is very important. That means size will reduce. And then what are the different types of topologies available? These compensation topologies. These are the different compensation topologies based upon your requirement actually. Okay. You need to, this is the table which indicates what is your requirement. How can you realize that? Okay. That is indicated by this. Okay. So these are the different methods available. Right, and these are the different compensation topologies available in the literature, and then especially right now LCC, both side LCC topologies are right now currently used in the literature. LCC topologies are giving better results compared to these topologies. These are conventional topologies, series parallel, parallel series, parallel. Especially in the electric vehicles, LCC topologies are currently they are using. Now, I'll be going into the case studies, what you have developed in the lab. You can see here, this is one of the system you have developed. I'll show you the hardware pick also. This is your complete, so from source to the load, source to the transmitter, you can see these are the coils, switching coils, transmitter coils. And then this is the receiver, which is charging your ultracapacitor. And ultracapacitor is driving, this is the load mechanism actually we have developed. Okay, using this, you are running your BLDC motor with some load. Okay, so this we have developed in the lab to demonstrate this wireless charging system. Okay, so how can you design now? Okay, suppose I want to run this motor having something like 600 watts. Okay, That means the load requires 600 watts, 600 watt power. Okay, then you need to design the coils to deliver 600 watts to your load, right? So in between, other components also there. You need to properly design to get at the load side 600 kilowatts. So how can you design this WPT coils, especially in this entire system? Coils, design of coils is very important. Actually, that plays a major role in operating your WPT system. So that means this is the process we have followed. What type of we have to collect first the specification. That means what is the load voltage, what is the load power, and what is the current it requires. Is it continuous current or peak current, and what is the voltage range you can operate? All these things you need to select. You need to collect the data, and then based on that, you need to work out on the what type of coil structures you need to select, okay? And then what type of compensation topologies, and based on that, you need to design the coils, okay? And then first you design the coils in a simulation software, either in ANSYS or in Magnet, and then based on the values you obtained from the simulations, you have to take it into your circuit simulations, which are nothing but LTSpice or MATLAB, and then you need to find out what is efficiencies you are getting, and then you need to freeze your design. Okay, so this is the flow chart for designing of the coils, and then your wireless power transfer system will have all these components. This is your coil former, in the sense coil. You'll be placing coil here. Suppose I'm making a circular coil, and you will be placing inside the circular coil. And these are the, you can see here, the plastic cover. Sometimes you'll be using here with aluminum shielding. Instead of plastic, you can place the aluminum shielding here. Okay. And then this is a coil which is placed here. Okay. And these spoke type black ones are there. These are called the parade cores. Okay. And then there is aluminum ring, aluminum backing plate. Okay. So what you have to do now? These are the different components of a single coil. That means it has to be there in transmitter and receivers. Okay. So that means these are the different components: a coil former, coil, plastic cover. This makes everything. And then this has to be placed on this plastic cover. You have to place this ferrite bars, and then the entire thing has to be fitted into the aluminum ring, and then back it has to be supported by aluminum backing plate. Okay, these are very important actually. If you do remove this, then there is a lot of interference actually by external field. So it will avoid the interference actually. So it is called the shielding plate. Okay, especially you can protect your device, your transmitter and receiver from your external fields. Okay, so you need this. Okay, so this is about the coil, how you design actually circular coils, and then how they look like in the design. And you have different types of DD coils are there, circular, trapezoidal, and even pentagon type. Different types of coils are there. Okay, DD coils, non-polarizer pad, different types are there. Depends upon, there's no standard for this, in the sense you have to use only circular coil for the EVs. There's no rule like that. You can go for the rectangular or square also. That depends upon the customer actually. And then these are different types of cores available. Okay, coil. These are the coil shapes. That means you can see here coil shapes. These are the cores available. Based upon the convenience, you can select anything, and then you need to select the remaining system. And these are the systems you have developed in the simulation software, and then we have analyzed. Okay. And this gives you the magnetic field intensity, how the flux lines are leaving from your transmitter, and this gives your field distribution, how the field is distributed in entire coil, circular coil. This is not the spiral one. This is a circular concentrated. It's not a spiral. Spiral means it will start from the center. Okay, so it's a circular concentrated coil, and you can see here how your flux density pattern of the transmitter coil, and if you see both the transmitter and receiver, okay. So anyone, if anybody want to do a work on the wireless power transfer system, you need to start from your coil design first, and then later on you need to find out the remaining things. Okay, so first you'll be going for the coil design, electromagnetic simulations, and then you need to find out what is the your inductances of your coils, both the transmitter and receiver, what is your mutual inductance and all those things, and then further you will be analyzing it. Okay, and then this is another way of doing it. Okay, you can see the bottom one is the big transmitter, and the top one is your receiver coils. Okay, the circular ones. Even this the bottom one, bigger coil is your transmitter. Suppose I want to transmit the power to the four different loads, four different batteries, also you can do it. Okay, or a big two transmitters and two receivers. Okay, that also you can do it. So we have analyzed circular cross-section, circular coils, both transmitter and receiver are circular. Then how the misalignment, okay, misalignment means that plays a major role. If the coil and coil is not perfectly aligned, your efficiency will fall down. Okay, so what will happen if you misalign the coils are misaligned, how the efficiency is changing, that is indicated in this graphs. Okay, and similarly different core types, we are adding different core types, coil types and core types. We have changed the coils and cores and then analyze the efficiency, how rectangular, spiral and rectangular coils are different in terms of efficiencies. Okay, and if suppose if I am changing the alignment, then 15 degrees, 5 degrees, 4 degrees, then what will happen to your efficiency, that also we have worked out. Okay, this is the adequate setup what you have developed. These are different components, okay, of this wireless power transfer system. Okay, so using this we have analyzed misalignment. If this coil, you can observe here, we can move up and down. Okay, suppose I am changing the distance between the coils, the transmitter and receiver, then what is the efficiency, how the efficiency is affected. Okay, and what we have done, you can see this groove, you can move right side or left side also. Okay, so if you take the center to center and move left side or right side, that means what? Misalignment in the x direction. And then if you move in the upwards and downwards, that is in the y direction actually. So in the both the cases we have tested, and then we got the results. And next one is just now what I said, as I explained to you, misalignment effect. Okay, so you can see here two coils are there. Okay, so with the two coils you have verified, these are the transmitter one and transmitter two, and we have established a communication system also between the receiver and transmitter. That means whenever this perfectly aligned with this, then you will be sending the power. And then this is moving, this is the top portion of your this is the receiver, and these two are the transmitters. Okay, when this is moving this direction, okay, it's perfectly aligned, then TX1 will be excited, and then this communication will be there between these two. How much charge is there in the battery and all will be displayed using this Zigbee and microcontroller unit. We have transmitted the signals, and then it is leaving here and it is aligned with this TX2. Then again, there is a communication establishment will be there, and it will disconnect power to this, and it will switch on your R2. You can see R1 and R2 is there. R1, whenever this receiver is aligned with the transmitter, R1 will be on. That means power will be transmitted to this. And then it is moving this side, and we are aligned with the transmitter too, R2 will be on and R1 will be off. Okay, in that way we have demonstrated dynamic system actually. With a less speed, very small, with the hand we have moved actually. So this is the simulation and hardware results. It is almost matching. So we have published in this. And similarly, then how can you control the charging track? In the sense, how can you identify when to switch on? Another method we identified. So in the inside the charging track, you have seen in the video, inside the charging track, you may have the any vehicle come inside, right? You can identify that. How to identify that? That we have worked out on piezo disc method. You can see these piezos are placed at each and every before the coil. You can see at a distance it is placed, and near to the coil it is placed. You can observe this. The four piezo discs are the two coil, four piezo discs. Okay, whenever this vehicle is entering into this line and it is crossing the PZ disc 1, it will communicate with and this is excited. You can see here, whenever it is passing on the PZ disc 1, then only this MCU will give signal, switch on this coil 1. Okay, otherwise it won't switch on. Okay, and then it will be communicated to your receiver and driver. You will have to give a command saying that you can charge. That means whenever driver is receiving a command, that means what, it is an electric vehicle. So in that way, we have identified, we are able to charge two ultra capacitors which is placed on this, and even using a mobile, we are controlling this. So these are the flow charts we have developed to do that. Piezo-disc method. And this is the, you can observe here, whenever transmitter 1 is aligned, transmitter 2 is off. Transmitter 2 is on, transmitter 1 is off. That means in this way, we are able to track the, you are able to control the charging track. Okay, you can also display on the dashboard. Okay, these are the ways we can display on the dashboard. Okay, aligned or not aligned. Okay, we are getting into the dashboard. And then another way of doing it, okay, it is continuous tuning of your frequency. See now, when the vehicle is not perfectly aligned, okay, there is a misalignment, that means this load resistance will be entirely different. That it is aligned and not aligned. In that case, the load resistance is different, and then we will be able to, using this voltage sensor, we are able to find out what is the resistance, what is the voltage and equivalent resistance, and then based on that you will be switching on your zero voltage switching inverter, which is placed here on the transmitter side. That means you will be tracking continuously using MPPT controller. We are able to sense the equivalent load resistance, and based on that you will be switching on your inverter. Okay, so this is one of the publication you have received in IEEE IET transactions. Okay, another way of I'm going to propose two methods. See now here, we have implemented, we try to implement it on the two-wheeler, instead of the battery is there and the supercapacitor is there. Simultaneously, you can transmit the power. Okay, so whenever it is required, this SB and SSC will be controlling the coils. Okay, the transmitter is fully connected. Okay. Suppose I want to charge the supercapacitor, this SSC will be on. I want to transfer the power to the battery, this SB will be on. Depends upon the driver conditions, the power transfer will be taking place here. Next is the multiple loads. You can see here, this is the transmitter side, this is the receiver side. You can transmit the power to the multiple loads also. Suppose I want to transmit the power between these two, distance is 30, but between this load and this load, the distance is 10 centimeters. Still, you can transmit the power. Okay, this is also another concept we are proposing. And then next, we are going into the charging ecosystem. In this, if you see, this entire thing is a EV charging ecosystem. That means a vehicle and EV charging station is only. People will think that electric vehicle and EV charging station is sufficient to do anything. Okay, that's not the way. You need to work out with all these people actually. OEMs and vehicle service management, managing fleet, grid monitoring, energy generation and remote user monitoring. We have completed here, up to this we have completed WPT system. Now I am entering into what is the EV charging infra, what are the conditions, and then what are the levels of EV charging required, wide charging especially in the systems. Okay, so this all these put together makes a EV eco charging system. And then what is EV charging framework especially? You can see here EVSC, EV charging stations, EVSC management. This is electric vehicle supply equipment. Okay, management, and then power generation to the grid. And then this I have taken from the Mahindra A20 Mahindra website. You can see all these things makes a framework actually, EV charging framework. Okay, and then what are the other things required. Okay, suppose you can see this from the generation, transmission, and then consumption. Okay, but even if you have a battery support, you can feed it here. Okay. So this grid is not available. You need to power with this battery systems actually. So EV charging, it may be anything like two wheelers, three wheelers, four wheelers, battery bus, or anything. You need to cater the needs actually. So, and then what are the infra required? Okay, what is the complete EV charging system required? You can see generally you will be getting 33 kV line. From that you need to reduce to the 11 kV, and then you will be having PLF panels, and then the chargers. Okay, and then depends upon the depends upon the company, you will be having APS, okay, and then you will be managing it. And then these are the different types of charging standards available. You can see here CCS standards in the America side, CCS standards even in the Europe, and GBT in the China, CHAdeMO in the Japan, and Bharat chargers. These are the different standards we will be following right now across the world. Okay, CCS, GBT, CHAdeMO, and then Bharat chargers. These are the three different, especially four different charging standards available in the world. Okay, so now we're coming to charging sockets. Okay, what are the charging levels? AC charging, DC charging, DC fast charging. You can see here, AC charging, especially at the residential places, level one. Okay, especially level one. DC charging, workspace or public place. DC fast charging, especially in the public and intercity places. And then these are the sockets. Okay, each and every socket is having a standard actually. And then these are the onboard AC charging standards available, and sockets based upon the based upon your charging standards. Okay, these are the different types of sockets available. And then you can see fast charging standards. What are the different types of sockets available in the market? These are available right now in the market. And the next very important concept is your OCPP topology. As per Bharat EV standards, you need to go for the open charge point protocol concept that we have developed actually with our students. So OCPP means on the top layer, okay, you have the different layers of your charging system. On the top layer, suppose your vehicle is entering into the charging station, once you plugged in, how you are going to bill that person actually. So that you need to establish, that you need to get it from your OCPP standards, OCPP protocol. Okay, so this, whenever you enter into the charging station, you need to swipe your card or you need to enter the passcode. Once you enter the passcode, then it will start charging. Okay, it will indicate, okay, whether it is charging or not. We, Ramesh, is entered into the charging station. It's charging and charging is completed. Okay, in that way you need to establish, okay, in a particular charging station, how many EV supply equipments are there, right? So how many are connected, any error is there, all these things you need to do it using OCPP protocol. Okay, so now you can see the conclusion here. So till now we have discussed about static and dynamic charging systems, and then I have shown you some of the case studies, the feature directions, and then EV charging infrastructure, it's especially in the wired one, and OCPP protocol as per the Bharat EV standards. And then these are some of the acknowledgements. I have worked with these people while doing all these WPT systems. Dinakar Prasad sir, director at Sivanagar University, my PhD students, and these are some of the BTech students and PhD MTech students worked with me. And then I would like to show you one of the conference what we are organizing in GRIT. So especially in the electric vehicle side, you can submit these papers till August end. The calls are open. And these are the general chairs and program chairs. Thank you. I'll be showing another video before stopping, which will give you the idea of
why you need wireless charging, especially dynamic wireless charging.
That's all from my side.
Thank you. Any questions?
Welcome to the world's first self-charging electric car. Let's do a walkthrough. This vehicle operates on an electric motor.
Hello. Yes, thank you very much, sir.
Any questions are there? I'm ready to take.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Questions are ready, sir. 2 minutes, sir. I'll just deliver the questions. Yes, sir. Yeah. First question is, I request all the participants first to place your questions in the chat box, or else you can also raise your hands so that I can unmute you for asking questions with sir. First question is, sir, what type of converters are used in wireless charging systems, and which type of converters are most widely used nowadays in starting systems?
Yeah, the converters are multiple types in the sense transmitter side converters are there and the receiver side converters are there. And then in the transmitter side especially, you need if you talk about from DC to DC, you need a high frequency inverter. Currently people are working on the ZBS and ZCS based high frequency inverters to improve the efficiency. If you are able to design a full bridge inverter along with your compensation topologies, that makes you along with the compensation, that gives you the ZBS property. So if you are able to design a full bridge topology at high frequency, okay, that is sufficient actually for especially EVs in the transmitter side. And similarly in the receiver side, you need to have the high frequency rectifier and DC-DC converter to control the power to the battery.
Sure,
yeah,
sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. And our next question is, how is it possible to charge the planes?
Planes, nobody said. Planes, it's nowadays wireless is difficult, okay. Drones, it is possible. See now, suppose I have suppose I'm talking about a application of surveillance drone. So surveillance drone, which is happening in a specific area. So you can place the charging pads on the rooftop of a big building. Then what will happen is the drone will come there and charge and go back to its destination actually. It's like that. Okay, drone and UAVs. Planes, right now, it's people are not working on the planes. It's very difficult actually. Right now, plane. But with high frequency and with the lasers, people are working on with the lasers and all. People are using lasers, they are transmitting the power. The lower side, not the higher side actually.
Gotcha. And the next question is, in India, where these wireless charging systems are adopted?
Right now, no one is adapting. People are working still. Tata Motors and few companies, they have started working on this wireless charging systems. Okay, and even GE, Global Research Center, they are also worked, but especially commercially, it is not available in India. Commercially, it is not available, but still in the research stage in India. But in the Western countries, it is available actually.
Sure, sir.
That's a.
Yes,
is it a
and yes.
Yeah. Yeah, fine, fine.
And you can, next.
You can continue. Yeah.
Next question is about charging and wireless charging. The main advantage and also having the difference between two, sir.
You know, very, very important advantage is, just now I have shown in the video, autonomous driving. So where is the wire required there? Okay, right? So whenever you go for the autonomous driving, okay, it is very, very useful actually. Suppose you have a factory area. I'm placing the goods from one place to another place. Okay. And I'm using an electric vehicle. Okay. And that too autonomous. Okay. Carrier, you can call it like a carrier. So one place to another place it is moving. So it has to go there and then it has to charge, right? Suppose it is a wireless concept is there. It is very easy to charge. And then it will go further and then it will do work, right? So if suppose it's a wide one, someone has to come and at least plug it, right? And after that, the control is very easy. But someone has to come and then plug it, right?
Yes.
That is a very important thing. But in the, especially in the dynamic side, dynamic wireless charging, very important thing is why the EVs are lagging behind the conventional vehicles. The first point you say is the range, okay? The range is very limited, okay? With the dynamic charging, range anxiety is removed actually. That is a very important thing. Okay, but still people are working very hard to get the efficiencies and then the, because a lot of limitations are there. As I said, the charging pads has to be embedded onto the road, okay? So as per our road conditions, how can you embed onto the road? That is very, very critical one actually. So if you are able to solve that, then it is very easy to adopt.
Yes, sir, exactly, sir. Our next question is, sir, just we have seen in the video, sir, a car is going on electric road and it is charged as long as it is moving on the road while motion. But how the bill will be paid to by the car owner to the electricity consumed? And how it will be vehicle company?
Yeah. Yeah, that's what, see, whenever the vehicle is entering the track, it has to be identified by using number plate. It has to be identified, the vehicle owner, okay, right? And then,
yes, sir.
Whenever it is entering into the charging track, the power consumption is there in the charger itself or in the power electronic circuits, using power electronic circuit, wherever the wall socket is there or in the main roads, right? Wherever you are placing, okay? So there you need to create a mechanism to create a billing to that, especially to that particular car, right? Car owner. Okay, you need to create that. One of the example what I shown you is the OCPP protocol. So that's what people are using in India at least. In abroad, some other protocols are used, but OCPP is mostly widely used in the world itself. Okay, so using that mechanism, you can able to bill the customer actually. You need to identify first. That is very important. Once you are entering into that charging track, the way by using number plate or some other mechanism, you need to identify what vehicle owner first, and then you need to start billing it. It is there already. Sure. The communication system is already developed about this.
How much time it will take for full charge of battery, sir?
So right now, 15 to 20 minutes is also available. Right now in the market, using DC fast charging, you can do it in 15 to 20 minutes. And then you have up to 88 hours also, okay, right? That depends upon the customer need, okay? Suppose the customer is not going for next 12 hours somewhere, then you can go for the slow charging. Why you have to go for the fast charging? That depends upon the customer. Suppose you are moving on the highways and then your charge is depleting. That means within 5 to 10 kilometers, your battery will be completely depleted. Okay. So you need to go for the nearby charging station and then wait for 15 to 20 minutes. Right now it is available in especially in the US and Europe, it is available already. Okay. So you need to go there and charge for 15 minutes and you can go up to some another 50 kilometers or 100 kilometers, something like that. That depends upon the customer actually, but technology is available right now. 15 to 20 minutes, it can charge. Even somebody is climbing within 10 minutes or 5 minutes, you can charge up to 80% of your batteries. That type of technology is also available.
Thank you, sir. And next question is, what is the level of interference of WPT on communication systems? How to overcome this?
As per the standard, as I just now indicated, in the, especially in the electric vehicles, we are operating at 85 kilohertz. So interference level is very negligible, actually. There is no interference level. Based on at this frequency, there is no interference level. It has proved already. With the wireless power transfer, you don't have any interference with the communication system at this frequency. See, you may be, if you are operating with very high frequency in megahertz and all, especially in the EVs, then it may create a problem. But now at 85 kilo, the standard is 85 to 89 kilohertz you need to operate. Okay, that is a standard you have to follow. Not only me, not only in India, across the world, everyone is following 85 to 89 kilohertz as the standard for the EVs. At this frequency, the interference level is very negligible. People are claiming that even it is zero also.
One more question, sir. If research has to be done on the interfacing basis, then which part is more efficient now, sir?
Interfacing means what is that?
If research has to be done in interface with RES.
What is RES?
I think it is renewable energy sources, sir.
Interface with renewable
energy. Chargings. Battery charging, we need to have the source one, sir.
Source
stations, charging station.
Charging station. You want to work in the charging station?
RES. Yes, sir. With renewable energy source.
That means it is not at all related to this WPT, right? That's what you're asking.
Okay. It is not related, sir, actually.
Right now, grid integration only. Grid integration of these renewable energy sources. How efficiently you are integrating to the grid, and then how you are managing the energy between the devices. Suppose I am integrating PV and then diesel and then wind. All these things I am integrating, suppose, to the grid. Okay. Yes. So how efficiently you are integrating it. Okay. That is very important.
Yes.
How you are managing the power between these sources is also very important. That is also still now also very critical, actually. Okay. So these areas you can work. How you can integrate, how can you manage the power? What are the different algorithms to create it? How different algorithms to manage the power? So those areas you can work.
Sure, sir. And participants, if anyone is having any doubts, please, you can raise your hands so that I can unmute you. You can directly ask your doubts to sir. Subramaniam, sir, please, I have given the option for unmute. Please, you can unmute and ask the question, sir. Subramaniam, sir.
Hello, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. You can ask the question.
Hello. Yeah, sir, I'm Dr. Subramaniam from Warangal.
Yeah.
Sir, you told three levels of charging, AC, DC, and DC fast charging.
Yes. Yes.
For charging the electric vehicles.
Yes, sir. Especially in India, as per the Bharat EV standards, you have the three levels of charging. AC level one and AC level. On what factors? Yes, please. Yeah, on what factors?
They depend, sir, on the usage of the customer.
See, the difference, that's what. See, now you generally AC level 1 charger is with a single phase supply. And if you go for the AC level 2 charging, you want to charge it in very less time, then you have to go for the AC level 2 charging, especially in the residential areas. And suppose I want fast charging, people are preferring the DC fast charging. It's not in the home and all. Generally, you have sufficient time, so go for the level 1 or level 2 charging. But whenever you go for the public places, DC fast charging is preferred.
Okay. That depends on the distance, sir, of travel.
That depends. That's what. That depends upon. Suppose you are moving on the high. You have planned for the some 200 kilometers of travel, and then suppose your battery is going dead, okay? You need to charge, go to the nearby station, right? So if you put there AC level 1 charging, you have to wait for 6 hours actually, okay? So so that's the reason why you have to go for the DC fast charging there. That depends upon the distance as well as the customer actually, the customer need.
Sure, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. And we are having one more participant, sir. G. Divya, madam, please, I have given the option of unmute. Please, you can ask the questions.
Sir, is it possible to implement regenerative braking in dynamic EV system?
Dynamic EV system, it's very difficult because, dynamic EV charging is efficient when you are moving at some minimum speed. Suppose regenerative braking is very efficient when the vehicle is moving with very high speed, right? Because kinetic energy will get very high when the vehicle is moving at higher speeds, right? So, but in the on the dynamic charging, if you want to implement, it is very difficult because generally you'll be traveling on the charging track with the lower speeds, not with the higher speeds. So there it is not efficient actually. While charging itself, you want to make the dynamic charging and the braking simultaneously, it may be difficult actually.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. It has not mentioned clearly the position, sir. Then solar panel for rooftop.
While moving means it's fine, but with low, you get very low efficiency. See, if it is stationary and having not properly placed, and if you are having a shade, then your efficiency itself is very low. And when it is moving, still you will get a low efficiency. But anyway, you can charge it. Generally, the concept is while moving, suppose you want to charge, one concept is there. You can charge to the secondary batteries. So primary and secondary batteries you have in the vehicle, you can use the secondary batteries, and then that power will be used for the auxiliaries in your vehicle. Actually, that type of concept, few researchers have implemented actually. Because you get very low power, sending in very low power to the main batteries is not a viable thing. So why don't we charge this the secondary batteries, and then use that secondary battery's power to the some other purpose in the vehicle. It is possible, but with lower efficiencies.
Okay, sir. Next question is, what is the rate of charging of battery from solar, sir? How fast we can do it?
See, that depends upon your capacity, right? Suppose your rooftop of your vehicle is very small, right? Area is not big. You cannot charge entire, you cannot fully charge your battery. Suppose I want to use it on the three-wheeler, the rooftop size is very small, and then you may have the two or three or solar panels having 200 watt capacity, but you have a battery of 3 kilowatt hour battery will be there, okay? You cannot charge completely, but you can charge a little bit, and that may extend the range up to some 10 kilometers or 15 kilometers. You cannot charge completely. That is not possible because your rooftop is limited actually. But in the home side, your roof is big. As much you want, you can keep it and you can charge the batteries. But on the vehicle side, you want to charge completely, it is not possible. How much rate, again, that depends upon your size of your solar panels, right? That depends upon size of your solar panels, the capacity of your solar panels.
Sir, and one more question, sir. How do you compensate harmonics which are produced by high frequency inverters?
Methods are there, both in that, both on the, you're talking about harmonics present on the supply side. Supply side, you can take care by using filters actually. Okay.
Yes, sir.
But in the charging side, using the inverter, you are going to using different modulation techniques, you are going to compensate. But in the supply side, you need to use the filters, input side filters, and all those things you need to use, and then you need to compensate the harmonics. There is no other way.
Okay, sir.
Sure, sir. That's all. Any of the participants? Yeah, one more question we have reached, sir. Due to wireless charging, is there effect of reactive power on the grid, sir?
Definitely it will be there. Okay, reactive power effect definitely will be there because you are transferring the power to the huge area. It will be there, but we are going to reduce that by using your compensation topologies. That's what I told you while in the presentation. You can compensate it by using, see, LCC on both sides of wireless power transfer system is nothing but the reactive power elements. Okay. So these will provide you some of the power to the some of the reactive power compensation actually. So that is a way you can reduce it, reactive power. In that way, you can also reduce the harmonics actually.
It is a modern concept which is going to be implemented in our country also in future. It brought a great ease to the participants. Was enormously useful for, I think it is for very enormous research scholars and also for PG students and also the faculty. The research scholars who are working on electric vehicles, with your permission, sir, can they get the scientific inputs from for their thesis work from you, sir?
Yeah,
definitely. Yeah, sure. Which in turn will help in stimulating participants as well. Sir, we have grabbed a lot of new concepts from you about electric vehicle. I express my profound gratitude to you, sir, for upgrading our apprehension. Thank you very much, sir.
Yeah,
I think one of the coordinator of faculty development program, Mr. K. Ramesh, associate professor, to remit the vote of thanks of the session.
Sir, Imran sir, I'm audible.
Yeah,
yes, sir. Sir. Yes, sir.
Good evening, one and all. Myself, K. Ramesh, associate professor, Department of EEE, and one of the coordinators of this FDP. I'm very much delightful to convey vote of thanks on behalf of our department. Let me express my heartfelt gratitude to our today's eminent speaker, Dr. Fanindra Babu Garu, for sharing valuable information on applications to wireless charging system in electrical vehicles with participants of this faculty development program. I'm sure participants would have learned more from this session, which will enhance their knowledge and professional career. It is my privilege to thank our honorable management of Bageshwari Group of Institutions, General Secretary Dr. G. Srinivas Reddy Garu and Joint Secretary D. Srinivas Reddy Garu for boosting and assisting us for conducting this type of activities. It's my pleasure to thank our beloved principal, Dr. C.H. Srinivas Garu, for continuous support and encouragement for organizing this FDP. I also express my heartfelt thanks to our beloved HOD, Dr. M. Ramesh Garu, for providing continuous guidance and sincere efforts to coordinate this FDP. I extend my sincere thanks to all our department faculty who helped either directly or indirectly for smooth conduction of today's session. Thank you. Thank you all. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thanks you. Thank you for giving me the opportunity. Thank you. Thank you, Ramesh Garu. Thank you all.
Can I stop?
Yes. Sir, over to you.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Thank you. Thank you.
I request all the participants that we have already placed the feedback link of day 3 in the chat box. I request all the participants to utilize it and submit feedback soon. And it has been observed that in the chat box, many of the participants are asking for the presentations. I have already informed in the chat box also, I repeat again to all the participants that all the videos, whatever the session videos we are going to record, it is going to be uploaded in our college channel, that is Bageshwari College of Engineering YouTube channel. I request all the participants, this today's video also will be uploaded today before 8 p.m. Hence, I request all the participants to utilize our college YouTube channel and subscribe it and get the all the lecture videos from it. And tomorrow's schedule will be as usual from 4 p.m. to 6 p.m. And tomorrow's topic is also a new topic. I think today we had learned a lot from Fanindra Babu sir about the electric vehicle. Some new topics we came to know from sir. And from the deepest of my heart, I thank Fanindra Babu sir for his valuable time given and also accepting our invitation. Thank you all. Thank you very much for the session. I repeat again, please, all of you, to utilize the feedback link soon from it so that before I end the meeting.